everyone, and welcome to Varsity Tutors, where today we are so excited to celebrate International Women's Day and Women's History Month with a very special lesson with our friends at the Molly Brown House Museum. Now, today we're going to have the opportunity to learn all about women's suffrage and the key women and events that led that movement with your expert instructor, museum education specialist, Jen. Now, before I hand it off to Jen, I want to make sure that we are all prepared to learn, to collaborate, and to participate as much as possible in today's live lesson. First off, you'll want to be sure that you have something to write on and something to write with. So that can be a piece of paper and colored pencils, pens, markers, anything of the sort, because we're going to have the opportunity for a small craft where you'll learn how and in what ways we can have our voices heard. And we'll also want to be sure, speaking of having our voices heard, that we're asking questions throughout the lesson. So Jen's going to have some questions for you. You'll probably have some questions for her as well. So feel free to use that chat panel on the right-hand side of the screen to both ask and answer questions throughout the lesson. Now, if we don't get to those questions right away, not to worry, we're going to save about 10 minutes at the end of the lesson for Q&A. Now, you'll also want to be sure that you have your cameras close by, because toward the end of the lesson, we're also going to have the opportunity to lean into the screen and pose for a selfie, potentially with your craft if you've been following along today and you'd like to show that off. And if you post those selfies on Instagram and you tag us here at Varsity Tutors, as well as the Molly Brown House, you'll be entered to win a 3-month subscription to VT+. I'll talk a little bit more about that prize and the specifics on how to enter toward the end of the lesson, but for now, I'm going to pass things along to your instructor for today, Jen. Take it away, Jen.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jen Kindick, and I am the Museum Education Specialist at the Molly Brown House Museum. So a little bit about me. I have a master's in archaeology, and I'm a certified teacher here in the state of Colorado. But today, we're going to be talking about women's suffrage and soldiers in petticoats from Seneca Falls to suffrage. All right, so when Margaret Molly Brown was born, most women did not work outside the home, engage in politics, or travel alone. They did not wear pants, play sports, and they certainly did not vote. Now, Margaret Brown's own story reflects the changing role of women over the last 100 years. Margaret Brown lived in Denver in the late 1800s, early 1900s, in a house near the state capitol. That house is now our museum, and we tell the story of Margaret and all the amazing things that she did for Denver and for the United States. One of the issues that was very important to Margaret was the right to vote. In the United States, women were not guaranteed the right to vote by the federal government until 1920, only a little bit over 100 years ago today. So today, we're going to be taking a look at the history of the women's suffrage movement and why voting is important. So before we dive in, let's take a look at some vocabulary. So a little bit of a pop quiz here. You're going to put your answer in the chat. Suffrage means A, suffering, B, the right to vote, C, an angry woman, or D, disenfranchisement. So what do we think suffrage is? Go ahead and put your answer in the chat. Definitely kind of sounds like suffering, but it might be something else. All right, I see a lot of great answers coming in. And I think those of you who got the letter B, you are the ones that are correct. Suffrage is the act of voting in an election. And so it's actually enfranchisement. You may have chosen D, disenfranchisement, because it sounds like enfranchisement. So what does disenfranchisement mean anyway? Well, when we add the dis to the beginning of a word, it means not. So for example, if you are disqualified, you are no longer qualified. So in the case of voting, it means that you can't vote and you can't have a voice in government. So until 1920, women were disenfranchised all throughout the United States because they did not have a voice and the right to vote. Now, here again is that definition of suffrage. We're going to take a look at a little video. The title of this class comes from the movie Mary Poppins, not the one that came out a few years ago, the one from 1964. Mrs. Banks is a suffragette, and she sings about getting women the right to vote. I'm going to stop the share for a second to make sure I have my sound going, and I do.
Crusaders for women's votes. Though we adore men individually, we agree that as a group they're rather stupid.
Mrs. Banks!
Cast off the shackles of yesterday, shoulder to shoulder into the fray. Our daughters' daughters will adore us, and they'll sing in grateful chorus. Well done! Sister suffragette.
Be that as it may, I do not wish to offend, but I...
From Kensington to Billingsgate, one hears the restless cries from every corner of the land. Womankind, arise! Political equality and equal rights with men. Take heart, for Mrs. Pankhurst has been clapped in irons again. No more the meek and mild subservience we. We're fighting for our rights. Militantly, never you fear.
If I may have a word, Mrs. Banks.
So cast off the shackles of yesterday.
Mrs. Banks.
Shoulder to shoulder into the fray. Our daughters' daughters will adore us, and they'll sing in grateful chorus. Well done,
Banks.
What is it, Katie?
Not this title. Now, Mrs. Banks is, as I said, a suffragette. And so there are these two words, suffragette or a suffragist. Now, this is because the British and American suffrage movements called themselves by different names. So the women in Britain also fought for the right to vote in their country, and they were called suffragettes. Whereas the women in the United States who fought for the right to vote were called suffragists. And you'll notice that there is a difference in the colors they used to represent themselves. The suffragettes used green and purple as their colors, while the American suffragists used yellow and purple as their colors. So very quick, we're going to define a few more vocabulary words that we'll be using throughout the program so you have an idea of what they mean. The first one is activism. This is the policy or actions of using vigorous campaigning to bring about political or social change. So all of the women that we're going to be talking about today who fought for the right to vote were activists. They wanted to bring about both political and social change by fighting for the right to vote. The right to vote nationally was guaranteed by a constitutional amendment. So, another quick pop quiz. What is the Constitution of the United States? So, go ahead and put your answer in the chat. The Constitution is A, our breakup note to England. B, a measure of how the United States is doing. C, a set of rules and laws for Americans. Or D, the name of a ship. So go ahead and put your answer. What is the Constitution? That really big document that you probably hear people talking about all the time, especially if they're lawyers or judges, talking about the laws of the United States. All right, and the correct answer is C, a set of rules and laws for Americans. But you're also not really wrong if you chose D, because the USS Constitution is the name of a ship that is now a museum. So the Constitution is a document that contains the rules and laws that were established when the United States became a country. Now, the Constitution is a living document, and that means that it can be amended, it can be changed. So what is an amendment? A constitutional amendment is an addition to the United States Constitution. It takes a bit of a process to make this happen. It's not an easy process, and it takes a long time for an amendment to be passed. And for it to be added, it needs to be voted on by the House of Representatives and the Senate, so that's the Congress of the United States, and then it has to be ratified or accepted by 3/4 of the states. So again, it's a long process, but that is how women eventually did get the right to vote, by constitutional amendment. So let's talk about the rights of women in the early 1800s and why it was so important for these women to start fighting for their rights. So in the early 1800s, unmarried women actually had more rights than a married woman. If you were not married, you could choose to work, you could spend your money however you wished, and you could buy, own, and sell your own property. However, as soon as a woman got married, everything she owned became her husband's property according to the law. So including any money that she had before her marriage, it then became the husband's money, or anything that she owned, any houses or property, any land. Once she was married, it officially became her husband's and not hers anymore. And there were a few things that no woman could do, regardless of if they were married or not, in the United States. Women could not run for political office. They couldn't vote, and they could not attend college. In the mid-1800s, women started to come together and say, why can't I vote? Why can't I attend college? Why does everything belong to my husband under the eyes of the law? I'm a citizen of the United States and deserve the same rights as men. And thus the women's rights movement began. So let's rewind in time all the way back to 1776. In a letter dated March 31st, 1776, Abigail Adams wrote to her husband, John Adams, urging the Continental Congress to not forget about the nation's women when fighting for independence from Great Britain. The future First Lady wrote, "In the new code of laws, which it will be necessary for you to make, I desire you would remember the ladies. If care and attention is not paid to the ladies, we are determined to foment a rebellion and will not hold ourselves bound by any laws in which we have no voice or representation." But alas, the ladies were not remembered in the Declaration of Independence. Instead, the Founding Fathers wrote, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men were created equal." They did not include women. Fast forward to July 1848 in Seneca Falls, New York. This is when the first women's rights gathering launched the women's suffrage movement. Known as the Seneca Falls Convention, organizers Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Lucretia Mott, which you can see on my screen here, along with 300 other men and women, gathered to discuss women's rights. Their work was influenced by the power and the rights of the Iroquois nation nearby. Elizabeth Cady Stanton said that the equal rights of the Iroquois women with their own land was proof that all American women had a natural right. The Seneca Falls Convention resulted in the Declaration of Sentiments, Grievances, and Resolutions, which outlined the idea that women should be treated as free and independent citizens that they were, in the style of the Declaration of Independence. Now let's see why voting matters so much. So first, let me see how many dog and cat people we have out there. So if you are a dog lover, put A in the chat. And if you are a cat lover, put B in the chat. So dog lovers, A. Cat lovers, B. See, we have a lot of both. Lots of dog lovers and lots of cat lovers. Maybe a few more dog lovers. All right, so now that we know where we stand, dog lover or cat lover, I'm sorry, I had to make you choose one. I know that can be hard. We're going to hold a vote today to see if we should have a virtual cheese pizza or pepperoni pizza. But here's the catch. Only the dog lovers get to vote. So, all right, dog lovers, what will it be? Will it be cheese or pepperoni? So dog lovers, you're the only one who gets to vote on this one. Give me an A in the chat if you would like cheese pizza, or a B in the chat if you would like pepperoni. Nope, remember, only dog lovers. All right, I think cheese is winning this one, although I see a lot of votes for both kinds of pizza. So cat lovers, how did it feel to be excluded from the decision-making? You know, drop your thoughts in the chat. I know it doesn't feel fair that that was the reason why you couldn't vote. Just because you liked cats instead of dogs, suddenly you're not allowed to vote in this decision. So dog lovers, how did it feel to exclude cat lovers from a vote? I know it probably didn't seem very fair for you guys to have that power over the cat lovers because you're all equal. You're all the same, no matter what. So would the results have been any different if everyone had voted? We're going to do a vote one more time to find out. All right, so everybody now, whether you're a dog lover or a cat lover, put an A if you prefer cheese pizza, and put a B if you prefer pepperoni pizza in the chat. See, it's so much nicer when everybody gets to have a say and everybody has the right to vote in even something as simple as voting for your best pizza. It doesn't feel good to be excluded from something like that. All right, I see we've got lots and lots of answers and pretty even. I'm still gonna say maybe cheese is the one that is the favorite here. All right, so women in the 1800s felt just like you did when they didn't get to vote. They said, my opinion and my voice matter, and so that is why they fought for this right. Now, during the Civil War, the women's movement suspended their activities to aid in the war effort on either side of the divide. During the war, women helped raise money for the war. They made bandages and gloves. They sewed blankets and uniforms. They delivered supplies to field hospitals, and they served as nurses, even on the battlegrounds sometimes. And so suffragists believed that once the war was over and the country was reunited, that the American leaders would recognize the work that women did during the war and give them the right to vote. The women expected that the 14th Amendment, which would grant suffrage to newly freed slaves, as well as Black and white women. However, this did not happen. So the 14th Amendment states that anyone born in the United States is a citizen and is granted equal rights and protection under the laws. And it penalizes states for denying their vote to men. For the first time, introducing the word men into the Constitution. The 15th Amendment stated that voting rights could not be denied on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. So this meant that if you were a freed slave, you would now have the right to vote. But again, the amendment does not say anything about women or gender. So in 1872, Susan B. Anthony, another very famous suffragist, got together with her sisters, her mother, and some friends, 14 women in total, and they decided to vote in the national election in 1872. Anthony argued that while the 14th and 15th Amendments did not say that women could vote, it also doesn't say that women can't vote. Women just aren't mentioned at all. So 2 weeks after voting, Susan B. Anthony was arrested. Here is a newspaper that was published at the time depicting Susan B. Anthony. She was fined $100 and told the judge, "I will never pay a dollar of your unjust penalty." And Anthony never paid the fine. Then in 1875, the Supreme Court ruled that the Constitution does not grant women the right to vote. So Susan B. Anthony realized that they needed a constitutional amendment to give women the right to vote. In the years between the end of the Civil War and that 1875 Supreme Court decision, states in the West had begun to give women the right to vote. In fact, on December 10th, 1869, Wyoming's territorial governor signed women's suffrage into law. It was written into the state's constitution when it became a state in 1890. 2 months after Wyoming gave women the right to vote, Utah also enfranchised women on February 2nd, 1870, giving women the right to vote in local and territorial elections. But then they actually took away that right to vote 17 years later. In pioneer days in Colorado, some women were allowed to vote in mining camp governments. But when the territorial government was set up, they followed the traditional view of only allowing male citizens to vote. Attempts to pass women's suffrage through the territorial legislature failed twice in 1868 and in 1870. And when the state constitution was written in 1876, there was an effort to include women's suffrage, but there was the fear that the constitution would be rejected if it included it. So as a compromise, women were granted suffrage in school elections. In 1893, Colorado women enlisted the help of national suffrage leaders when they sensed that a third attempt at suffrage might actually succeed in the state. The governor supported suffrage, and out of 44 newspapers that were surveyed, 33 were pro-suffrage and only 11 were opposed. On November 7th, 1893, women's suffrage in Colorado was passed by the men of the state. It passed by a vote of 35,000 to 29,000. Susan B. Anthony was exalted. Despite her lack of involvement, she proclaimed, "Well, I can't believe it is true. It is too good to be true. Oh, how glad I am that at last we have knocked down our first state by the popular vote." Colorado became the first state to give women the right to vote by popular vote. And by the time the 19th Amendment was officially ratified, the Colorado women had been running for office and voting for 27 years. So returning to Margaret Brown for a bit, Margaret and her family were living in the mountains of Colorado when the 1893 referendum passed. The state of Colorado became a focal point in the national debate. Margaret and her family eventually moved to Denver and became much more active civically and politically. As her opinions matured, Margaret's politics began to fall in line with those of the progressive movement. She rejected strict gender roles and acceptable behavior of the Victorians and began to embrace the optimism of the progressives, who believed in equal rights for all and that social injustice could be changed through new policies and government reform. By 1910, Margaret had turned her focus to Newport, Rhode Island. Newport was another hotbed for the suffragist movement, and it was there that Margaret met Alva Belmont. In July of 1914, Margaret worked with Alva Vanderbilt Belmont to host an international suffrage convention that became known for its location at Alva's Newport, Rhode Island cottage, Marble House. This great conference of women celebrated women's rights with activists from all social classes invited to attend. The two-week conference attracted women from both America and England, who renewed their dedication and inspiration for the cause of suffrage. Margaret gave an address on opening night, and throughout the conference, she hosted many lectures at her Newport home called Mon Etui. All right, let's take a pause and another vote. Where are my cat lovers? Okay, it's your turn now. You get to vote. This time, you get to decide whether or not we should have dessert for breakfast. So cat lovers, it's only you this time. Give me an A for give me yes, dessert for breakfast, or a B. Oh, no way. No dessert for breakfast in the chat. Cat lovers only. All right. Dog lovers, how does it feel to be excluded from decision making, especially having the vote before? So drop your comments in the chat. It's kind of like the women of Utah who were given the right to vote and then they got it taken away 17 years later. It's what it's like to be a dog lover right now. All right, I know it doesn't seem very fair that suddenly you lost your right to vote. All right, let's see what the results are in when everybody now gets the right to vote. So everybody can vote, dessert for breakfast. Give me an A in the chat if yes, I love dessert for breakfast, or B, no dessert for breakfast. I see some dessert lovers out here. More dessert, more breakfast. Sounds good. All right, so at this point, much of the world was becoming involved in World War I. As the Victorian era gave way to an era of change, women like Margaret Brown, Alva Belmont, and a woman named Alice Paul led the way. Alice Paul, a radical suffragist, showed women's voting strength by protesting against anyone in political office who was against suffrage. Alice Paul organized a parade down Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington, D.C., to happen at the same time as President Woodrow Wilson was arriving for his inauguration in 1913. Her parade had so many people that the president asked why more people had not come to see him. They were all at the parade instead. The 8,000 women who marched were tripped, jeered, and spat upon by the men. By the end of the day, over 100 women had to be hospitalized for injuries. However, the women did not give up. They finished the parade. Alice Paul's tactics were seen as too extreme for some women, so she started the National Woman's Party. Paul adopted the philosophy to hold the party in power responsible and punish those parties who did not support suffrage. The Silent Sentinels were a group of women organized by Paul and the National Women's Party. They protested in front of the White House during Wilson's presidency to serve as a reminder of his lack of support for suffrage. In 1917, police arrested protesters Lucy Burns and Catherine Morey on charges of obstructing traffic. They could spend 3 days in jail or pay a $10 fine. They chose jail. A week later, 16 women were arrested and sentenced to 60 days in jail or pay a $25 fine. Again, they chose jail. Alice Paul was arrested and sentenced to 7 months in prison. She was placed in solitary confinement for 2 weeks with nothing to eat except bread and water. She became weak and unable to walk. So she was taken to the prison hospital, and there she began a hunger strike. The prison doctor said that Alice Paul had a spirit like Joan of Arc, and it is useless to try to change it. She will die, but she will never give up. By early 1918, Alice Paul's tactics worked, and President Wilson finally announced his support for a women's suffrage amendment. When the Senate voted, however, it failed by 2 votes, and arrests of the White House protesters resumed. To keep up the pressure, protesters started burning the president's words written on banners in front of the White House. In speeches, Alice Paul urged citizens to vote against anti-suffrage senators who were up for election. After the election, most were in favor of suffrage. In June of 1919, the 19th Amendment granting women the right to vote finally passed and was sent on to each state for ratification. Ratification means each state had to agree that women across the U.S. could vote. And on August 26, 1920, the needed 3/4 of the states ratified the 19th Amendment granting women full voting rights. Now, while the 19th Amendment was a huge win for women who had marched, they'd been arrested, or even died for the cause of women's suffrage, the 19th Amendment really only applied to white women. While the beginnings of the suffrage movement had partnered with the anti-slavery movement, some white suffrage leaders discriminated against Black suffragists. They prioritized the right to vote for white women over advocating for the equality of African American women. Millions of other women, African American, Native American, Asian American, were barred from voting for decades. Some states and cities ignored the 19th Amendment by creating poll taxes, forcing voters to take reading tests, and requiring citizenship. Mary Church Terrell and Ida B. Wells Barnett were not only members and founders of groups like the NAACP, they also formed the National Association of Colored Women, which gave Black women a national platform to advocate for suffrage and women's rights. Black women were not welcomed by white suffrage leaders, even in 1913, and Alice Paul, of all people, asked Wells Barnett to march on the back of that big parade. Wells Barnett refused and instead marched with all of the white Chicago suffragists, which you can see in this photograph. It wasn't until the passage of the Voting Rights Act of 1965 that all women of color were able to vote. This law outlawed discriminatory voting practices. Some Latina, Native, and Asian American women had to wait until 1975 when the government passed additional voting rights laws. Alice Paul once said, "I always feel the movement is like a mosaic. Each of us puts in our little stone, and then you get a great mosaic at the end. So now it's your turn to put in a stone. Make your own poster that tells people why voting matters. It can be a cause that you're passionate about or just voting in general. So use your paper and your pens, your markers, whatever you have with you, to start working on your poster. And while you're working, I have some examples from the suffrage era that I will show you, along with some more political cartoons from the time." So we have about 5-10 minutes, and I'll show you some political cartoons. So here's a photograph from the National Women's Party after Colorado was given the right to vote. They created this billboard saying, "Women of Colorado, you have the right to vote. Get it for the women of the nation by voting against Woodrow Wilson. Their party opposes national woman suffrage." So again, remember how Alice Paul, her whole plan was to get people out of office who did not support women's suffrage. So this is one of the ways that she did it. "It means freedom for women to vote against this party, the party this donkey represents." So again, we're trying to get these people who do not support women's suffrage out of power. This is a very famous photograph of one of those silent sentinels. holding a sign saying, "Mr. President, how long must women wait for liberty?" And then we have a lot of political cartoons of the time that came out both in support of suffrage and against suffrage as well. And this says, "I want the vote and I mean to have the vote. That's the sort of girl I am." This is one of my favorite political cartoons. It's called "The Lid Is Off Again," and showing this kind of devil-like person taking the lid off of society's box. And if you look at all the little pictures that are coming out, it's showing women doing all the things that only men used to do. They're playing golf, they're fencing, they're riding horses, they're driving cars. They are being served by men at the dinner table. They're talking to a judge. So, oh no, women are going to do all of the things that men are doing if we give them the right to vote. This is another one that came out during World War I, where women again were fighting in the war as nurses. And so this one is, "If you are good enough for war, you are good enough to vote." This one's a play on the story of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, where suffragists can be these kind of angelic looking, peaceful women, or the kind of other side, these women who are portrayed as these very ugly, angry looking women who are fighting for suffrage. This is another great one too. Election day and the woman is leaving the babies with the husband. The kitchen's a mess as she is leaving to go vote. So again, that was kind of the fear of men, of society, that women were leaving their role that they have as the wives, as the mother, as the caretaker of the home. And if they went out to vote, suddenly the dad, the men, would have to do all of these things that used to be just for women. All right, I think we are time and ready for that selfie, maybe.
All right, so as you all get those cameras at the ready, if you're still working on your artwork, on identifying what idea, what cause you'd like to speak to, and figuring out how to put that in motion using some of the inspiration that we saw today, by all means, that is absolutely all right. But if you do have it ready, feel free to lean into the screen with that poster. And as a quick reminder, if you post those selfies on Instagram and you tag us here at Varsity Tutors, as well as the Molly Brown House, you will be entered to win that 3-month subscription to VT Plus. So if you love learning, and judging by the fact that you're here, you very likely do, VT Plus is the perfect after-school opportunity to explore new subjects and learn more about your favorites. We've got dozens of live classes to choose from every day after school, as well as hundreds of on-demand classes. It's $10 a month for the whole family, but a lucky winner today will get 3 of those months for free. So let me go ahead and pass this along to Jen. And Jen, you can try to show us that poster once again and see how that works.
Oh, there we go. So I have a coloring page of one of those photographs of the women carrying their banners during a parade, although my background likes to blur it out.
Ah. Symbolic, maybe so, but thank you so much for sharing with us. Now, we do have a couple of minutes left for a few of those questions. We've got some really wonderful questions coming in, so let's get to them. Now, one of the biggest ones that came up, and you hinted at this a little bit earlier on in the lesson, but we had all of these women who at the time chose to go to jail rather than choosing to pay the fine. So could you talk to us a little bit more about why they would make that choice?
Sure. Well, it was all, remember how I said Alice Paul was a radical suffragist? That meant that she was willing to go to any length necessary in order to get this right to vote. And so what these women were doing was basically making national headlines in newspapers. They were being very public with what they were doing, holding these parades, holding signs, picketing in front of the White House. It was no longer just talking to each other in clubs or hearing lectures. They wanted to be very present and very public with what they wanted. And so if you just paid a fine, well, that doesn't really go that extra mile to prove that you are willing to literally die for this. You know, Alice Paul went on that hunger strike while she was in jail. And luckily, they changed their mind before anything serious had happened to her. But that's why they went to jail. So it was very public that you are putting women in jail because they want the right to vote.
Absolutely. Now, we also got some questions around today. So currently, as we speak, does everybody, whether it's here or around the world, does everybody have the right to vote? Do we have equal rights in that capacity? And if not, could you talk to us a little bit more about that?
Sure. That is a great question. I don't necessarily know about, you know, voting rights across the world. I'm pretty sure in most countries, women absolutely have the right to vote. But, you know, here in the United States, we have constant news about laws being passed to make it more difficult for people to vote. So we had those Voting Rights Acts passed in the 60s and 70s. But today there's different ways that people are kind of trying to get around that by maybe making it more difficult for you to get to vote. As this is especially for people with disabilities, Native Americans, they have a hard time voting because of physical limitations of where they can go to actually vote. You know, there's a big discussion about mail-in votes, if they should be legal, who should be able to use them, and things like that. So it's kind of constantly changing. In some states, if you commit a felony, if you commit a crime and go to jail, a special level of crime, some states do not allow you to vote after you get out of jail. So it really depends on the state and, you know, how they feel and how easy they can make it for people to vote or how difficult they can make it.
Absolutely. So it sounds like in many capacities, the battle to make sure that everyone has the ability to have their voice heard isn't entirely over. And so this brings up a really great follow-up question, which is how can students become more informed? How can they learn more about what prominent issues are facing people today and what the different sides of that story might look like?
Yeah, I mean, I think just, you know, keeping your eyes and ears open, really thinking about the sources that you're hearing news and information from, especially on the internet. You know, anybody can say anything that they want on the internet. So make sure you're listening to people who know that what they're talking about, who are credible sources. And, you know, there's always a place for even kids to make a difference. You can write to your congressman. You can write to your state senators. You can talk to them. Just because you're a kid doesn't mean that you can't. So you can do little things like that and know what's going on in the world, even though you're a kid.
That is awesome. Now, we also had lots of questions kind of going back to the lesson and some of the images that we got to see, some of the stories that you told, lots of questions around, you know, we had men who were clearly against at the time a lot of these movements. Were there men who were in favor of women's suffrage? Were there women who were against women's suffrage? Talk to us a little bit about that.
Of course. Yeah, of course, on both sides. There were men who were absolutely in favor of women's suffrage. And, you know, I talked a lot kind of in the beginning about what women could and couldn't do. And that was the legal definition. So under the law, that's what it said. That doesn't mean that every husband was like an evil person who didn't let their wife do certain things. I'm sure that they were husbands who were, you know, did not think of their wives as equals, but that was the legal definition of what you could and couldn't do. So definitely men were absolutely on the side of suffragists. A lot of the husbands of those women I talked about, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Lucretia Mott, they were married. And so, you know, they had very supportive husbands and families as well. And then also on the other side, there were many women who didn't think they needed the right to vote. They thought, well, my husband can vote for me. Why do I need to have a say in this? This is a man's, you know, part of society. And so there were people on both sides, men who supported it, women who did not support it. And then finally, they all, you know, kind of came together and figured it out. You know, as I said, in Colorado, it was 35,000 people for it and 29,000 people against it. So it just kind of depended on, you needed, you know, one more person to be in favor, been opposed for it to actually get passed.
Awesome. Now it is getting to be about that time, and you've already given us some really wonderful thoughts and advice around how students can learn more and can become more informed and even more involved. But do you have any other final closing thoughts that you'd like to leave with the class?
I don't think so. Just remember that even you can make history. It doesn't matter who you are or where you're from, you can make history too.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Jen. Thank you much so much to the entire team at the Molly Brown House Museum. Thank you to those of you who tuned in, who followed along with today's craft, who asked such thoughtful questions. We hope to see those crafts on your Instagram posts, so definitely feel free to include them. And don't forget to tag us here at Varsity Tutors, as well as the Molly Brown House. But in the meantime, we hope to see you all in another class real soon. Thanks so much.
Thanks. Bye-bye.